Again, that October jobs report smashing expectations on the headline, 531,000 payroll adds in that month, the unemployment rate dropping to 4.6%, and average hourly wages surging by 4.9% on a year-over-year basis. Again, the street on the headline number was only expecting 450,000. The ADP report that we got yesterday, which was beating expectations, may have forebode what we saw today. But let's continue the conversation about this report. We've got with us Betsy Stevenson over at the University of Michigan, in addition to Emily Rowland at John Hancock. She's a strategist there. And Emily, I want to ask you about the wage side of things, right? 4.9% year-over-year increase. We were just talking about hyperinflation. Again, Betsy really putting that in the coffin there. But is there signs of wages really becoming stickier when it comes to the inflation story as we continue to see these pretty hot wage prints?
Yeah, certainly wage growth came in right as expected, but 4.9%, that's a big number. I think there's a couple things to think about here. One, it's very much concentrated in the services sector. That's obviously a part of the economy that's benefiting as we come back to life, you know, post-lockdown as the economy reopens. But I wonder what the future of wage growth actually looks like. Are we going to be able to continue to work from home? We've had major investment banks in New York City saying, if you want a New York City salary, you need to come to New York City. So it's going to be interesting to see if wages actually start to reflect the fact that, you know, companies have really benefited from a cost perspective with their employees, you know, being at home and continuing, we're continuing to benefit from earning the same amount of money, but not having to spend in order to, you know, make those commutes. So I think an interesting dynamic there in terms of wage growth, maybe it comes down. I think inflation in general, we do think will subside into the back half of 2022. Chair Powell talked about that yesterday. You know, there's mathematical reasons for that, which is that those base effects, which have been flattering the numbers, will start to go from being your best friend to your worst enemy into 2022, if you want to think about it that way. And we also see supply chain challenges getting resolved. We see labor force shortages getting resolved as those extra unemployment benefits continue to expire and bring workers back in 2022. So a lot of reasons to believe that, you know, I hate the overuse the T word, but that inflation will ultimately prove to be transitory.
Betsy, what is the secret sauce to solving the labor shortage crisis in this country?
Oh, recognizing that workers are people and they want you to treat them kindly. I think that's the real secret sauce. I mean, some of it's obviously showing up in wage gains. And, you know, I do think if you look at this report and you're like, these jobs went disproportionately to people with less education, and yet we saw big wage gains. That just shows us the pressure there is in leisure and hospitality to pay higher wages. But, you know, the job has gotten undeniably worse if you work in any kind of customer service role. People are rude. They're mean. You have to deal with, you know, telling them to put their mask on. They could actually physically assault you. You want to put people in those conditions, they're going to demand higher wages. And I think we're going to have to reckon with that. You know, do we continue to treat people in a way that means they just don't want to do those jobs for us anymore, or that we're going to have to pay them a lot more to do it? I think that's sort of a different phenomenon from things like, you know, what's happening at the high end of the labor force where people have been able to work from home. Now, there's actually a lot of demand still for like legal services and other sort of professional services. And I don't think the fact that people are staying from home is going to put downward wage pressure on those types of jobs. What I do think will happen is, you know, we saw record applicants to law schools this year. We're going to see a flood of new lawyers on the market. I think that, you know, increasing labor supply is what ultimately puts downward pressure on wages.
Now, Betsy, can we look at the education sector specifically? Because everything that you just said also applies to those in the education sector as well. A lot of teachers having to deal with some parents that have a lot of strong opinions on vaccine mandates and whatnot right now. Now, employment decreased in local government education and appears to be little changed in private education in October. But the BLS in the note saying, look, pandemic-related staffing fluctuations have distorted normal seasonal hiring and layoff patterns, which makes it difficult to interpret. Do you see anything in the October or previous jobs report that tells you exactly what's going on here?
Well, I think the seasonal factors are all messed up when it comes to education. So I think that what we want to look at is, you know, sort of how many people are employed, you know, by October of this year, sort of compared to October of last year, instead of comparing, you know, how many people, how many jobs were added or subtracted between August and September, September and October. But, you know, the end of, I think if you take a look at the numbers, we see exactly what was predicted, which is we don't have enough teachers out there. We saw a lot of school districts, you know, people early retired because they didn't want to deal with COVID teaching. And they haven't been able to hire the people they need to get back in the classroom. Some of that's for the reasons that you said, that, again, the job has become harder. You got to either tell kids to wear masks or the kids are going to bring COVID into the classroom. You got to deal with parents, some parents who, you know, desperately don't want masks, some who do. You know, you've got to, maybe your classroom's even colder. At my kid's school, they're leaving all the windows and doors open to prevent, you know, to have fresh air. And my kids are like, it's freezing in there. So I do think the job has become worse and we're going to have to attract new people to that job. It takes a little while to do that. That's always a slower process. You know, this is what we said at the beginning of the pandemic. If we just bring everybody back into the old job they were doing before, that happens fast. Reallocating people into new jobs, it's a slower process. We got to negotiate and look and think. And what we're seeing is a very big increase in industry switching behavior, occupation switching behavior by people in the labor market. And I think that's really slowing things down.
Emily, maybe I'm reading too much into this, but that's what we do here. Is one of the reads off of this report that the market in 2022 can handle a Fed tapering program and maybe one rate increase? And by handle, in that backdrop, maybe the market could go up another 10%.
Well, I think the key benefit here is that Powell has been so crystal clear in his communications. He's been very, very resolute in letting us know what's happening. You know, clearly this week we found out, as expected, that tapering is going to start later this month. And that the Fed would like to see how that plays out and have flexibility in their mandate in order to watch how the economy is evolving and then make changes as necessary. And that was very much appreciated and by the equity market. You know, we continue to reach new all-time highs. The market is made of Teflon right now. Any risks that seem to emerge get batted aside. And we think that volatility is probably going to pick up, you know, next year, again, as we move away from peak growth and peak stimulus to an environment in which the economy is going to need to stand on its own two feet. So we'll need to find out if this is a self-sustaining expansion. But as for now, this new cycle continues to unfold. That's a good thing for equity markets, as is the fact that the fundamental backdrop remains incredibly strong, as we've seen so far with Q3 earnings season.
Emily, I have 10 seconds left. You want to weigh in on Peloton? Fire away. Floor's yours.
Not allowed to talk about individual stocks, although I'm going to get on my Peloton when we're done here. So maybe that's something.
Fair enough. Enjoy your ride. Maybe I'll see you on there myself. Betsy Stevenson, professor of public policy and economics at the Ford School at the University of Michigan. Good to see you. Emily Rowland, co-chief investment strategist at John Hancock. Always good to see you as well. Have a great weekend. Brian, there we have it. Emily saying, and I'm correctly noting, we have a Teflon stock market after this better than expected, or we may have a Teflon stock market after this better than expected jobs report.
Yeah, and for what it's worth, I mean, I think it's underscored by the fact that the market action that we've been seeing so far, when you take a look at those futures in the positive, probably have more to do with the earnings themselves than they do with the jobs report itself. So maybe the market is already getting ahead of what they expected to see, which was continued progress in the labor market. But at least for me, I'm a macro guy, so I am poring over the details of this report. I just got to say, Brian, across the board, this is a positive thing. If you have 500,000 people coming back to work during the month of October, that is a lot of healing, but I want to emphasize the magic number, 4.2 million. That's the amount of people that we still have left to get back into the labor force that we lost compared to pre-pandemic levels. We can do it. There's a reason why the Federal Reserve is trying to target pre-pandemic employment levels when they think about maximum employment. If you try to lower the bar on that, you start to tighten a little bit early, you leave people on the sidelines. Jay Powell doesn't want to do that. If it's going to be him or someone else who's going to be Fed chair, 4.2 million is the magic number they need to close there.